You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know. Even better if I'm already speaking by the time. So, like, as a usual Ian Skinner episode, it doesn't start with the classic, "Hello, you're listening to the Scottish Wrestling Network podcast. My name is Billy, and I'm joined here today by nickname, the one and only Ian Skinner." So it doesn't have to start like that. It can literally start with me rambling. But I did as well, in the middle of rambling, forget the point that I was going to make. Because I've actually been doing some interesting shit. Oh, fuck. We've broken the swear right away, probably like 30 to 40 seconds in, already broken the swear and thing. I don't even like swearing, like, in a wrestling sense most of the time. But here we go. I've actually been doing some interesting stuff. You know, since May, I've done things. I haven't really, but we can get into that as well, because it's a very short list. Go on.
Welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I think last time you were on properly, like, for a full episode, this is what happened as well. It was the quiz. One of the quizzes, anyway, that you...
Yes.
I hit record and you started talking. I was like, this is my podcast. This is what's happened.
Actually, it wouldn't have been the quiz that I was last on for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Because that would have been your birthday quiz. And I wasn't there for the birthday quiz because I was at a wrestling show that day. That was the day I faced Kid Bandit and Simon Miller with my man Big T. So it would have been before that.
Mm-hmm. I was the second quiz, because the third one you listened to.
Wait, no, Austin Powell's got. I'm sure did the gold member episode happen?
That was May. Yeah, May 23 was the gold member episode.
Yeah,
we've done quite a few. You've done five full episodes, and then you've popped up in other ones and done the quiz and all that kind of stuff. So you've been around, and it's always a pleasure to have you and Skinner on this podcast, because I really don't have to do a lot of work. The only work I've done is I watched Starship Troopers. That's literally it.
Oh no, what a crime. Because here's the thing, for new people who are like, I tell you what, I'm gonna start this podcast, this Ian Skinner on Scottish Wrestling Network's SWN podcast, I'm gonna listen to this one and work backwards rather than, you know, listen to episode one and work forwards, and then, like, because we're not gonna go over when I got into wrestling, who's trained me, who's inspired me, nothing like that. You probably should have heard that by this point. And also, I don't like talking about that. At this point, this is going to be minimal talk about wrestling. It's literally just going to be a ramble episode. I think that's what the start of my sentence was going to be. But yeah, this is the preliminary. Preliminary, I don't think that's the right word. The quintessential Ian Skinner talking on a podcast experience, in which it is fun and chat shit.
Interesting. You know? Yeah, interesting, yeah. is the catch-all word. But yeah, for anyone listening, there is a playlist called Ian Skinner Saga, where it does start with Ian Skinner as a wrestling interview, and they've just slowly descended into just I'd hit play and or hit record and hope for the best from that point. Because who should tether Ian Skinner? Nobody. That's who. We should just let him go. Because I watched the clip from the Halcyon show.
Yeah. Here's the thing, right? Don't try mesh words with your boy. And again, I wasn't even coming in that hard. Okay. Mm-hmm. I was just saying, hey, what do you mean by that? Man couldn't back... Lorne? Man with a sausage name? Couldn't back up it? Yeah, there you go. You were thinking it. You were thinking it. You were thinking it, and I'm the intrusive thought. Sausage man name, huh? He just couldn't back up his mustard. He just kept moving on to new tangents. Nah. I love an argument. I love tuning into a podcast, joining a Zoom room just to have an argument while my girlfriend's through the other room going.
Did you ever get the list? With the five?
No,
names?
I didn't. I didn't.
Shocking. Absolutely shocking.
Yeah. Yeah. Again, I thought the major insult there was, why don't you tell me what question to ask you, bruv?
I mean,
I've been around a couple podcasts.
Exactly. Like,
again, it's not as bad as ever wrestled Zack Sabre Jr.
Have you? I don't know. Right. So
question one.
I've already lost, and we're only what?
You want to start with questions?
Why not? We'll do some wrestling shit and then get into the hard and fast subject matter of this particular episode, which I did have a tagline for it, which I'll find when we actually get to the point of what we're doing. So yeah, May 2023 was the last time we had a full episode of Ian Skinner, where we only talked about wrestling for about 20 minutes and then did a thesis on Goldmember, which I was woefully underprepared for because I thought it was going to be a bit. And you started going into a bit like every scene. I was like, oh shit, I thought this was going to just be a silly thing and we weren't going to speak about it. Even though it is the best trilogy of films, bar none. Like every trilogy's got a weak one or they add a fourth. Austin Powers, just perfect. Perfect.
Well, to be fair, I feel that if he wasn't so old, he might have.
There's always like little ads they do, like we continuation 2 minute ads and things they do, but no, just keep it at three. They don't.
Yeah.
They.
It's like Lethal Weapon. Yeah, the perfect trilogy.
Never seen them.
But neither have I. However, my knowledge of the Lethal Weapon trilogy is from the WTF Collective, where there's essentially WTF Collective is one guy on a beat, but he's all these different rappers. So he's like MC Amnesia, all up in this bitch, woke up 5 days ago, lying in a ditch, didn't know who I was, I couldn't remember shit, apparently something happened that was traumatic, I used to hammer rhymes, but I can't remember then, seriously, I'm freaking out, I can't remember anything, what's my motherfucking name? No, seriously, does anyone know what my name is? So, and then there's one guy called MC Lethal Weapon 4, that's me. MC Lethal Weapon 1, 2, and 3. And then after MC Lethal Weapon 1, 2, and 3, which is his full name, is MC Lethal Weapon 4. And it's MC Lethal Weapon 4, that's me, I disagree with... pretty much he's... One of them is like, they had three perfect films. It was great. I don't know why they had to make a fourth. And the guy who's like, the fourth is like, oh no, I thought it was great, but I also liked Lethal Weapon 4. Because it had Joe Pesci in it.
Okay, so I have the same kind of opinion for Die Hard. First three, love Die Hard films. And then they made the fourth one. I'm like, why? Why did you do this?
Listen, they made the fourth. However, the best Die Hard film, and I think this is like such a fucking, internet article, top 10 XYZ. Is it Olympus Has Fallen or White House Down? I think it's White House Down with Channing Tatum and Jamie Foxx, which is the best Die Hard.
We'll do a fact check because, we're professional here. Yep, Channing Tatum, Jamie Foxx.
Because Olympus Has Fallen came out and that was Gerard Butler and... It's not Denzel. Someone, fuck it. We'll do it live.
Olympus is... Oh, no, it's Olympus, UK and Ireland. I think that's medical. I'm in the wrong area. Olympus Has Fallen. Well, 2013, yeah, came out at the same time. Yeah. Morgan Freeman,
that's it. But it's... The White House Down is the perfect Die Hard trilogy. Sequel. Whereas... Die Hard 4. It's very much focused on. Oh, I'm old. I guess I gotta get back into it.
which is deep, like what the third film is. So they did the he's old and alcoholic and all that kind of stuff, and it had Samuel L. Jackson and it had riddles. That's all he needed. Messing with it. Who's
my favorite? It's my favorite Batman film, which reminds me, Billy.
No, I haven't. I still haven't watched the Batman.
Dude, it's sick. Like, oh man, you're wasted on you, man. I feel that we've tangented. Why are we talking about films already? Even though we were talking about like wrestling. There was wrestling there for a point. And you're like, well, last time we were on, it was May 2013.
Yeah. That's fine. I knew that this is how it was going to go. So literally, I've got like four lines of notes, and that's it.
I remember we were talking about. You said we did an episode about Goldmember. I'm taking off the outfit right now, obviously, but I think the meme has occurred. You can get. Wait, one second. I'll put the bandana back on. We'll get a screenshot. And that we can, like, you know, put that on the socials, and then, yeah, this is the interesting part of the podcast where you get to hear me just sigh and grunt. Yeah, listen, audio listeners, love you to death. This is one that you're gonna have to watch, not gonna lie. But hey, if you want to listen to the audio version of this, feel free to do so. So let's get a little.
Yeah. Okay. I'm sure it'll be long enough for me to grab it. It'll be fine.
Yeah. Screen grab it. Yeah. All right. It's actually too warm. You're talking about, Goldmember is the perfect trilogy. And then I just took us on a long journey. So, yes, we did an episode about Goldmember.
I will say, though, before we come back to it, Zack Snyder's Justice League cut ruined my enjoyment of going back to watch DC films. I know it's not the same universe, but that's just kind of put me off going back. Oh no, and I watched Black Adam, and it was horrific. So
I would say the Snyder cut was much better than the James Gunn cut.
Still bad though. Still was not a good film.
It was a better film. It wasn't as goofy. It was very like, if you don't like Zack Snyder's like Jesus wanking, then like, oh yeah, no, so it's from Resurrection. Like Zack Snyder is really good when he's got like a co-writer. Watchmen, great.
Love Watchmen.
300, great. And then it's like, oh no, Zack Snyder's a great writer and director. And then he did Man of Steel, which was good. But again, it's an allegory for Jesus.
Mm.
And then he just kind of went off the rails because Batman vs Superman, the director's cut is all right, but it's still not there. Have you seen The Flash? Did you watch The Flash?
I haven't seen The Flash. No.
It's one to watch at home. It's enjoyable, and there's moments in it where I'm like, man, if Ezra Miller didn't kill and kidnap all those people, this would have been fine.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he killed people. I think for liability's sake, I need to say that he didn't kill people.
Allegedly. No, actually, not allegedly.
Despite the fact I do have a meme where it's Ezra Miller's statement after. Where is it? Ezra Miller. I'm just looking up memes on my phone and then bringing them up to the screen where it is. It's his apology.
While you're doing that, while you're looking for it, it was Joss Whedon and not James Gunn, just for fact checkers out there.
I want to apologize to everyone that I killed.
There's a screen grab. Just
you know what? Early. One day I want that to be my apology. You know,
but we don't talk about that. The Tims.
The Tims in 1998. Yeah.
Yeah. Before we go really into it, I'm just going to give a shout out because I'm really desperate for a sponsor, because I've still got a Manscaped sponsor technically. It's SWN20, manscaped.com. You can get 20% off and free shipping, but I'm really desperate to get a sponsor from Brewtoon because it's a really nice beer and it's Peterhead. It's local for me. So I was hoping to have Murray Cup.
Are they the cup? Brewtoon, do they not have the Murray Cup flavor, which
they
is similar to the disbanded drink that encapsulates an entire county in Scotland, Murray?
Technically, it was brewed in Peterhead, but yes, it's called Murray Cup, and I had a taste of it when I went up to see WrestleZone. There you go, there's a mention. And it was amazing, and I've been trying to find it since, and I went and tried to get it today.
I need to get my bingo card out. okay, WrestleZone. Brilliant. All you have to do is mention Aspen Faith and...
Any opponents that you want to wrestle after Zack Sabre Jr., is it including? Right, wrestling.
I'm trying to think of a third thing for the bingo gag there. So it's Aspen, WrestleZone, Aspen Faith, and
Caleb Valhalla,
dinosaurs.
Probably. I've tried to retire. I'm trying to retire the dinosaur question and the two sheep, one cow question. They're gone. This is a new season.
New season. Now it's all about bacon and games, guys.
Oh God, that quick. But I bring it back if I've got an episode and I'm really like not hitting that hour mark, I might throw it in because you know I want to hit that hour. I've hit 70 minutes for like every episode of the season that I've recorded. I mean, this is the first one that goes out, but the next four were like 70 minutes, nice and tight.
Oh, brilliant. Let's tighten that even further. Let's do a tight 45.
We won't even get onto the first question before we get to
What's the longest set you've done? You've done 20? We'd like to have you on the secret show. Inside baseball chat.
Right.
We'll move on. What were you saying? You want to get sponsored by Murray Cup, by Brewtune.
By Brewtune. So,
and you want to get some Murray Cup.
Because, because it's like fucking gold dust around about here. I kind of get it for a lot of money. I've got Juicy Beller.
It's called Dustin Rhodes now.
The natural. So I've got a Juicy Beller on the go. I've already drank sour something. What was it? Cherry. I can't remember what I'm called. Cherry something. It was really nice. So that's what we're powered by, that and Dr. Pepper. So if they want to sponsor me, that's even better. I'll be happy with that. Anyway, Solve Pro. That seems to be your big, big thing that's going on right now because you're quite active on the social media. You by your own admission, had a bit of a quiet 2023.
Do you want to go on like a proper dark tangent and then come back up? Essentially, in June, I broke my hand. Like, I felt like I was on a wild ride. So I had my tag team match with Kid Bandit and Simon Miller with Big T. I was then at OTT. Had my debut with OTT on their contender show against Jay Danny Cross. Incredible talent and, super insane. Like, he then faced Kenton later that year. Then I broke my hand. And I was out can't remember the weekage, but essentially I could not use my hand, couldn't train, like going to the gym was rough, tough. My first match back after that was September 30th at Disco. Also, that explains the Disco Derby fiasco, because it was literally maybe a couple weeks before, if not like maybe, but essentially I broke my hand. That's why I wasn't in the Disco Derby. I think it was like weeks before, because I remember getting my hair bleached fresh and then like turning up with a cast, and it sucked. Sucked major ass. Then I had my first singles match in September 30th. Then I had a scramble match at Solfro and then a tag team match, and that was my 2023. It was proper quiet. But people would not imagine that because I was very active on social media and I was like, cool, it's time to do promos, time to pitch ideas, time to get working.
Like, you're my ultimate example when it comes to that, because like you're saying, nobody, unless you outwardly said, oh, I've injured, I've got this, that, nobody would have known because you were so active. And that's why the start of this year, I was going, oh, if you got any, nobody asked, but I was like, if you want to get ahead anywhere, social media, fucking use it so much, because guys that I haven't seen wrestle yet but I want to see wrestle live, it's like Casino Brutale, because their stuff's hilarious, it's great, and I really enjoy it. Yourself, I've seen you wrestle once, but we don't talk about it because
it's an okay company. The person who did the ring job was bad. But the company was all right.
Yeah, so and that was a really long time ago, but you keep active because you keep doing the social media stuff, and it's it's such an important thing nowadays that people don't get it, and they don't even share the matches that they've got coming up or anything like that, and it's really just annoying to see. Yeah. And I'm up in the northeast. I'm not going to travel down to Edinburgh or Glasgow or that on a whim. I can't do that. So just let me know what your character is. Do that. That would be ace.
Yeah. Well, what is the thing? If you want my kind of like my thoughts and feelings on this, you'll have to subscribe to Impact Plus, because this is a topic I covered on Joe Henry's Food Fight. You may be confused about the Ian Skinner episode, because the introduction doesn't say Ian Skinner. The introduction does say Alex Zane. So I know me and him very easily confused. But that's a little pop from there. But yeah, I kind of like go in on that a little bit. He asked me about it because I think social media is just a part of my presence. It's funny. A promoter once said to me recently, I didn't know you could wrestle because I showed my match with Chris Ridgeway. As kind of like an example, I was doing a pitch and it was an example. It was like, oh, I didn't know you could like wrestle like that. Like, it's funny. I feel like, and you'll know this as well, I feel that I've literally flipped to the other side of the pancake, in which like I used to be the, oh, he's a wrestler and he wrestles and he is good at wrestling and he wrestles and he's a wrestler and he wrestles. And now I've flipped over and it's like, oh, he's just a character guy. I feel like that's perception. And obviously, perception is reality.
So when I was watching, I watched the first Soft Pro show, and I'm so behind with them. I've got them all like waiting to go, but finding like 3-4 hours of my day is just fucking impossible. But
just watch over the Ian Skinner segment. It's what I do.
That's all I'm watching them for, to be honest. I'm joking, guys. Please. I don't know what I was gonna say. Please give me money. I don't know what. Yeah, go for that. But yeah, so the fact that you did come in, I thought it was gonna be like a big wrestling match, and then you just fucked off right at the start and went to the commentary. I was like, this is amazing. You get it straight away, and introducing yourself to a new audience and that. So yeah, Soft Pro. Was that just? Did you just, like you said, are you just pitching ideas to promotions now and seeing what happens? Do you have
ideas? I think that was when I was on the shelf, it was pitching ideas to promotions. If I want to get kind of like down to the kind of like backstage, and I won't go too deep, but I think Software have really given me a platform and I'm really grateful for that. I really think it has kind of like turned my career trajectory in an entirely different direction for the better. Second part of that, the way they kind of like put together that first match, and it was literally like, how do we highlight these characters? Bomb. Mm-hmm. And they put that together. So that was their idea, like going to commentary. I'm like, hell yeah, let's do it. Because of all the promos I did in the lead up to it, they literally got kind of like going back to what you were saying, they got a perception of what the character was through the promos, or what they kind of like, what they got from the promos. They're like, let's put that in. But I've been able to work again closely with Soft Pro in building stories. I'm not going to say much less about it. And I know what you're thinking. You're looking at this right now. Like, what's that? It's actually a donut from Doughboys. It's a local place, to me now. But look at that. It's like a Homer Simpson level donut. Look,
beautiful.
As big as my head. I'm going to be eating that the rest of the show.
That is stunning. That is absolutely stunning.
Just so you're not distracted by anything else, like in the background.
I'm admiring your curtains, to be honest. It's a bold statement curtain.
That. I'm a cat dad now. That's a new thing.
Oh, right. Okay.
I'm a cat dad now. Yeah. There's a lot of stuff in my personal life that have changed. We'll not talk about that.
Well, I was going to segue saying that you put out the big promo that you're now in Yorkshire. You've got a flat cap and everything now.
Yep, 2nd of January, moved down to Yorkshire. New year, new me. but working with new faces, new perspective, new talent, a great crop of talent, and new opportunities that have come from it. So really grateful for that. And I feel like there's a lot of potential on the horizon.
I was noticing, like, you put out, like, if there's an open challenge or anything like that, you're quick to put out a little video to go with it for that opportunity. It reminds me, was it last year of Leighton Buzzard doing that for Rev Pro, was it? And then he got his match with Will Ospreay. Yeah. So it was that, I don't know if you're inspired by that, but was that kind of the thought process that if I keep presenting myself, then I'll get this opportunity kind of thing.
I feel that if someone puts out an open challenge, I always go in it with the mindset that there's never a real open challenge in wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
But to challenge perception and to get character across to new audiences, new eyes, new visions, surely answering an open challenge is the way to do that. But that's maybe just me being like tactful. And probably like even subconsciously on a level there, it is like Leighton got the opportunity with Will Ospreay. But that's like, I feel like a lot of, not chips fell into place, but it was the right time, right person, right moment.
Mm-hmm.
ICW champ, touring around the world, wrestling all these names, faces, like a perfect person for the opportunity. And then from that one match, trajectory entirely changed.
Japan, he's got Minoru Suzuki and all that kind of stuff, and it's just
Minoru Suzuki, and now he's got a match against the Rev Pro champion Mike Loku.
So yeah, so
Revolution Rumble.
But it's always working towards that right place. I mean, you never know when it's going to be as well. This has gone actually into a bit of a serious wrestling chat. What's happened here? The other thing that I spotted online when we're talking about social media was I saw the clip of your entrance at North for your North debut. Which is a promotion that I really want to get into. It's just again finding time, much like mm-hmm. for watching Solve Pro. But I love the vibe at North as well, and it was because Joe Hendry, someone you're incredible. Very familiar with, and I just like that intro. Joe Hendry's a big name, big star. He's got quite a big persona, and you came in kind of lampooning it straight away and just bursting. I don't want to say bursting into the scene like I'm some sort of journalist, but you really burst in there. Was that just perception?
Have you seen the full entrance?
I think have. Yeah, it starts with the Joe Hendry DNA entrance, and then it changes into the Diet Coke.
Yeah, I just knew that, like, Joe's got the tendency, not the tendency, that's not the word, but like the parody entrances, that's what really kind of like is getting skyrocketed him. That was his unique value and his unique trait. I was very lucky, which I didn't receive a parody entrance. And this is for shoots. I kept that under wraps. You can see it in his face. If you watch the match, you can see it in his face. He had no idea. And I kept that completely covered. There was a select few people who know who they are, who knew that it was happening, but I was like, this needs to be a prank.
Just how the turntables, you know, because when I was speaking to Scotty Duhati, yeah, I get Scotty Duhati on here. He was saying he was not told.
Sorry, let me just... There's that name. That's the name. You want it back? You dropped it.
He was saying that he never, he didn't know either. So he enjoyed what it was, but he felt like he should have known because he had to then change how he wrestled on the fly. Whereas, yeah, turnabout's fair play, I suppose, if you're doing it onto Joe and you're, that's, if you go back next time, then everyone from North's going to be, oh, it's the guy that did that to Joe Hendry and all that kind of stuff. So it's all.
I'd hope so.
It's all in the brain, in the brain bank somewhere. We'll see how the rest of the stuff I've got here. Les Battersby.
I wasn't involved in that segment.
I just wanted to throw out there because that was, I've again seen clips in that. Wrestling's getting weird. I mean, wrestling is always quite weird, but Mr. Blobby's turning up, Les Battersby's as Les Battersby, not Bruce Jones. It's Les Battersby. I feel like this is the most Ian Skinner thing I may have seen in wrestling because of the old Austin Powers Pro Wrestling idea that's still in the back burner somewhere. If you were to bring any soap stars in, have you got any picks?
I don't. Why soap stars, bruv? Why am I gonna go? Oh, I tell you what. I
reckon you've got a couple of the Mitchell brothers. Get them in there and just
who I know Phil Mitchell, but like I'd bring him in as Ross Kemp. That's why I had like a gang beat down, and then Ross Kemp comes out. But rather than like engage in the fight, he's like, "All right, yeah. what are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? You're gonna punch me? You're gonna forearm me? Yeah, okay."
I mean, Steve McFadden's doing Panto now, so he can come in as full. You're making me old in this conversation.
You're the one who's brought up soaps. I'm like.
All right, okay. TV cast.
You know who I would bring in? I'd bring in Neil Patrick Harris, Denise Richards, and Casper Van Dien. Bring them in as a trios.
Right. We'll go back to the wrestling in a bit then. That's the perfect way to bring into our main subject matter here for this episode that I've taglined, forget the insecticide, bring on the nukes. Because that was the tagline.
It's such a quotable film.
There's a lot. I just went with that one because I thought that was quite a tidy title. But I could put Kill Them All. I could put many things in there, but...
Yeah.
Unless we think of something on the go, like we did.
I'm from Edinburgh, Scotland, and I say kill them all. The only good pop's a dead pop. I don't know.
We'll get into the whole film, but yeah, I'll get into that particular point in a bit. So, Starship Troopers.
Well, okay, yeah. So, Starship Troopers, if you haven't aware, it's on Disney Plus. Watch it. It's my but where I come from in this is my favorite film. My dad showed it to me when I was like 3 or 4 years old. Because it's got guns in it. My dad's a military dude. I was terrified of it. It's probably the reason I've got arachnophobia for shoots, but it's my favorite film. I've watched it at least like twice every year. once every day, twice on Sundays. But it's my favorite film. I can quote it from top to bottom near enough. Pitch perfect. It's my favorite film. I love it, and I love that there's been so much love given to it now that Helldivers 2 has come out, and Helldivers 2 borrows a lot of inspiration from the Starship Troopers, kind of like aesthetic, but also the way it operates. If you've played Helldivers, you get it. If not, you are aware. Now go either play Helldivers or Starship Troopers.
I don't know if you want to go beat to beat for like everything that happened in the film or just kind of hit the point.
We could, and I'd be happy to. However, let's get your opinions on it first. Your kind of like your subjective opinions, because potentially you may be falling into the trap because it wasn't a blockbuster like hit by Paul Verhoeven at the time. It wasn't a blockbuster hit, but it's because it's a very nuanced film. And potentially, on a first watch, blind reaction, you may have fallen into the pitfalls that viewers at the time fell into, which is why I was like, oh, this film's garbage.
I'll tell you what I thought then. So I've never seen Starship Troopers until yesterday. So that's the 5th of, was it 5th? No, 7th of March, 2024. It was the first time I've ever watched Starship Troopers. Never knew anything about it. Just saw the cover. That is all I know about it. Right. I don't know if I like this film, and but I would watch it again. And what I thought was, it was unsettling. That's how I felt when it finished. I thought that was a really unsettling film. It had all the hallmarks of early 2000s, late 90s kind of teen thing, and then it just the interjecting ads things, they were really creepy, and the Neil Patrick Harris in the black, all black uniform. That was really unsettling. Yeah,
and what did that uniform seem like?
Oh yeah, it seemed very, very Third Reich kind of vibe. But yeah, I did a little bit of reading afterwards because I wanted to see am I wrong to find this unsettling? And when I was reading through things, I was like, oh, okay. I think I was in the right zone with this particular film. But like I said, I don't know if I liked it, but I would watch it again. That's the kind of weird zone I'm in with it. But so when rewatch for yourself then, on rewatching it over and over again, do you find new things? Do you find new kind of nuances? Or at this point, have you watched it twice?
Ish. I don't know. But I think there's points where it's just little things that get you, and it's the little details. Because obviously you'll probably have like, mentally, if I watch it 2 times a year, there's probably like a 6-month gap between watching it. Realistically, and then there'll be sometimes nuances or little things that still give you that, oh, Like, I only recently, I think it was a couple of years back, watching it in the pandemic, I realized that the news reporter at the start, obviously the news reporter at the start is the guy who interviews them in the spaceship. Mm-hmm. But some little things like that that I'm like, I never consciously thought about, especially because that first, the first scene acts as such a buffer with the news camera, which, and it perfectly sets the scene of what this film is about, but also preconditions the audience that the bugs are the bad guys.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And if you cut, it's a thought experiment I've always considered. If you cut that first section out and just started from Johnny Rico drawing Denise Richards' face on his little tablet, would the, would it read the same going forward? Because there's so, again, it's a pro, so for people who aren't aware, again, don't fucking listen to this podcast.
Oh yeah, don't. It is if you haven't watched it before, go watch it, because it's, yeah, it's something, just something about it.
Going blind. Also, visual effects wise,
it got worse as it went along, but that opening scene was incredible. I was like, oh my god, this CGI looks, this SFX or whatever, it looks amazing.
I think it rivals some of the stuff that comes out today.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what we watched The Flash the other day there. Ah, I still watch Starship Troopers, and there's a couple of things that I'm like, ah, that's definitely CGI, but there's, it mixes practical effects as well.
Mm-hmm.
And it's that little thing where it's like, oh, but yeah. News reporter getting absolutely murked. Then you see Johnny Rico controlling the line of people. Go, 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 get out of here now. Kitten turns around. No, 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 Kitten, no. Kitten's body gets thrown at him. He gets knocked down. He fucking does his last stand, gets stabbed in the leg. And you think Johnny Rico dies, screaming into the camera. Cut to Johnny Rico. And Mr. Michael Ironside, the Highlander, with his one arm, talking about the fascist utopia they're living in right now. Because you're listening to the, I don't know if you listened to the verbiage that he was saying, or if you were still mesmerized by the relationship and the love triangle between Denise Rich, well, between Carmen, Dizzy, and Johnny. But he's just talking about, like, the failure of democracy and how, like, oh, yeah, I wonder what the forefathers of Hiroshima would say. Well, they wouldn't say anything. Hiroshima was destroyed. Very good.
Mm-hmm. I don't know what it is about it. Like, it's not the same film at all, but there's probably some elements that you could throw in from either or. But I got a kind of a idiosyncrasy vibe.
Oh yeah,
from it.
And Idiocracy.
Idiocracy. Sorry. Again, film I've only watched once, and not one I'd go back to watch, unfortunately.
Yeah. But Idiocracy is kind of like in your face.
Mm-hmm. But there's so many themes that you could probably parallel.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Films of that the way of think about, yeah, Denise Richards, it's, she did very well with what she had. Thing.
Oh yeah,
yeah, but so yeah, smash
again.
Smash,
she's just a career girl. That's all she wants. So yeah, you smash cut. Where the fuck? Sorry, I let me order food quickly. Fuck this conversation. no, yeah, you give us the next setting and what you're. Like an overview, yeah.
We're in the school, and it turns into early 2000s, well, late 90s, early 2000s. Jock has got the girl, but the girl doesn't seem to totally be into it at the same time, and we've got a prom coming up. There's obviously the friend Dizzy is there as well, clearly in love with Rico. It's and then do their check all their exams so they can get into the next school. It's so cliche.
And Rico only gets 35%. Well, look at that, 35%. So Neil Patrick Harris there, he plays the perfect, I wouldn't say dickweed friend, but he just plays the perfect, oh, this fucking guy.
Mm-hmm. He's the friend that you would want but not want at the same time, going, he's probably really good, he's loyal and everything, but he's also a knob at the same time. So but yeah, so that was the thing, like the casting, because again, went totally blind. I didn't even know who was in this film, and when I was watching it and seeing Denise Richards, I was like, oh my god, that's for the late 90s, that was a pretty big name to have in there. And Neil Patrick Harris, of course, he wasn't as big of a name at that point, because he would be coming off Doogie Howser, and then
yeah,
and then he wasn't really doing much until this, and then was it Kamal and Harold and Kumar,
yeah,
as well, and then How I Met Your Mother. And as it went on, we'll get into it, the bigger names were coming in. I was like, oh my god, this is a
Michael Ironside, the fucking what's his man?
Clancy Brown from
Breaking Bad.
Oh, Dean Norris, yeah, and he popped up. And
Mr. Krabs, he's there.
No, I was just watching it, my god. And I thought I recognized the actress that played Dizzy, but I didn't. I hated him. I hated Ace.
Oh no, but he's perfect. But here's the thing, man. Like, yeah. Are we wanting to go through this chronologically, or are we just wanting to talk about Jake Busey's hand? But yeah, so we cut to this, like, this high school drama where it's essentially love triangle. Oh man, Johnny Rico doesn't know what he wants to do. And he's like, I want to join the military. And his parents are like, you won't stop because his parents seem like dicks, but again, on a rewatch, and looking at it from the lens of the military industrial complex, his parents the most sane people in this film. And I love the way the actor who plays his dad does the shit-eating grin. He's just like, maybe we could go to the outer rims. Zegama Beach.
So it was...
Zegama Beach, always wanted to go there.
From what I understand then, so democracy is pretty much fucked. In order to gain any leverage at all, you have to go through the military. That's...
citizenship.
Yeah.
Service guarantees citizenship.
And we find out just a little bit later on, and that's how you get things like licenses, you're able to have kids, do anything else.
Go to school.
Is have this citizenship. And it's...
you want to have babies. You've got to be a citizen if you want to have babies. That's the one that sticks with me. Fucking short ginger hair girl in the showers. Co-ed shower scene as well. But we'll get there. But essentially, it's a fascist kind of thing where it's just like, cool, war trumps everything. And all the adults, near enough all the adults in this film, are disfigured. The teacher has one arm. The science teacher, where they're cutting open that bug, Sarturian sand beetle, she's blind. Also, Lassie from the Golden Girls. You've got the guy when they go to the recruitment office, Neil Patrick Harris, Denise Richards, and Casper Van Dien, where Neil Patrick Harris, like, hands in his thing, and he goes, oh, wow, this dude's got one metal arm, and he's kind of like, oh, man, he's a veteran. He's like, wow, you're going to military intelligence. So Neil Patrick Harris, smart guy, going to military intelligence. Oh, we're going to the sign-up scene. I forgot about the fucking psychic scene, because psychics exist in this universe.
But the fetish.
You're psychic.
Yeah.
Maybe you are. So this is what... We can come back to it, but I think that scene, Neil Patrick Harris is practicing mind control on Johnny Rico because he knows that he's thick. He knows that he got 35% of that math score on that maths test. And he's like, can I make him think the wrong card?
Right.
Because we know he can control his ferret and think that there's a grub crawling up his mom's leg, but he can't do human yet.
Yeah. And there was always kind of like a wee sinister like pause to it as well, like going, well, he's trying.
But it could also be like, hey, yeah. Because Johnny's like, oh, I hope you don't do anything like that. Oh, I can't do human yet. It could be playful. But if you look at it through the lens of he's trying to make Johnny think of the wrong card. Damn. That's why he goes straight up to military intelligence. Denise Richards, she's a pilot. She wants to be a pilot. She goes to piloting school, and then this guy with the metal arm is like, where you want to go, Johnny Rico? He's like, oh, I'm going to mobile infantry. Ah, yes. Great stuff. Mobile infantry made me the man I am today. And not only does he have a metal arm, he has no legs. And you think, man, these guys, this is the last time we'll ever be together. Yeah. Yeah, let's meet in the future. Us three. Friends forever. Yeah? And then we get the most awkward goodbye in all of history. Johnny Rico gets kicked out because he's joining the mobile infantry, and his parents do not like that one bit. So they're like, as soon as you walk out that door and join the infantry, you're kicked out. Yeah, no more. You're gone. No Zegama Beach for you. And even his mom's like, oh, come on, Johnny. Because Johnny's only wanting to do this because Carmen, Denise Richards, she's Korean military. She wants to be a pilot. And the only way that they'll be able to get to work together at any point in the future is if he's a military man. And as soon as Johnny agrees that he wants to join the infantry, she's like, huh, my parents aren't home.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of that, we had the prom and then we had the weird futuristic indoor football game thing. Where we were introduced to Xander, who looked like 40
he's
years
the most after. 90s dude out there.
He looked like, I thought it was Wally Goggins at first, but because I was watching it going, is it? And then, but that's how Walter Goggins looks like now. So this guy, like, how is he part of this high school, college, whatever?
Well, he's a different college, I believe. Mm-hmm. Different college, but he's just on a different football team. Or potentially military industrial complex being what it is. They could just be part of the same school, but they're just put on different teams. And it's just like, go at each other. And this is where we get to see Dizzy being a great leader. Hey, Rico, you're drifting. Flip six free hole on mine. Just throw me the ball, Diz. And then you get to see Johnny Rico do some of the craziest flippy stuff. Mental.
So now we're into the military. They've now in, and we get to see Clancy Brown with unmistakable Mr. Krabs voice. Like, that was Mr. Krabs' voice. It wasn't Clancy. It was just so Mr. Krabs. It was unreal. I didn't understand. I only watched last night, so I have very limited notes. I didn't understand why the guy was laughing during the whole roll call thing, the whole big speech. I didn't quite get that, but I don't know if
I think it's just like maybe nervous laughter.
Right.
It could just be a response. It could be just he says something and it's Kitten. You know, it's our guy Kitten. He's a chirpy guy.
Mm.
But he's laughing and he has to do that. And I think it's the escalation of action, because what happens, Kitten has to run around that barracks. And then that dude pulls out the baton and like starts smacking him.
Chases him.
Who do you think has the nuts to go up against me? And then the farm boy jumps in. Sir! I think I do, sir! He's like a big, thick guy. Comes in, judo throw, breaks the arm. Wet, just like straight up arm is just out of place. And because the first and last thing out of your words is, sir, do you get me? Sir, it's my arm. I think it's broken, sir. And they just call for a medic. Just call for a medic. And a medic comes and heals his broken arm. Then fucking Dizzy shows up. She's like, I've got papers. I've transferred to this camp because I heard you were the best, sir. And what makes you think you're good enough? And then Clancy Brown just throws down with Dizzy. She gets one lick in. I think she throws a sick Tommy end kick. He sweeps her leg and just like chokes her out in front of Johnny. And the implication is, did she join to be with Johnny? Because the whole love triangle here is Dizzy likes Johnny. Johnny wants Carmen. Carmen wants to be a pilot.
That was my exact point I was about to bring up, was did Dizzy join the military or that particular branch because Johnny was there? So it's his story, but from the female side of things.
Well, as well, like literally in the next scene when they're in the cafeteria and dude's getting his arm healed up, and you get to be introduced to Jake Busey and his teeth, who should have their own credit in this film. Jake Busey being a piece, he's a piece of work, but what a guy, of course you are, anyone deserves to have a friend like me. And funnily enough, if you watch that scene again, Clancy Brown is watching in the back to test, or not a test, but also like observe Rico's leadership abilities.
Mm-hmm.
How can he control a line, huh?
And he de-escalated the situation and all that kind of stuff without having to resort to violence when it got interrupted by another bigger guy just pushing out the way.
Yeah. But that's when he even says to Dizzy, he's like, what, did you come here just for me? And she's like, no, I came in for my career. But later, co-ed shower scene, this is where we get the exposition dump. Boys and girls in a shower together. They're all having fun. But this is where we get that dystopian like look of like, so why are you here? oh, you know, I'm a farm boy. You know, if I want to get my own property, I need to have a citizenship. Why do you want to go here? Well, I got into Harvard, but of course, the expenses are too high. But if I serve, military pays the way. This woman's like, I want to have babies. And then Kitten, you find out that he's a writer. He wants to write. He wants to be a journalist. That's why he's asking all these questions. And then Dizzy just throws out like, oh, yeah, Johnny's here for a girl. And then Rico just like walks out. He's like, oh, I can't do any of this.
And then they ask Dizzy.
Yeah, is it you? And she gives a little coy look of, it could be.
You probably were thinking this at 3 years old, but I'm assuming that was the first pair on screen.
Probably.
Yeah. Breasts. You would have seen breasts. God.
Yeah.
Welcome to my pension, boys. I'm getting old.
Yeah.
I wasn't, again, coming in blind, wasn't expecting. I was like, oh, well, there we go. And then the next scene was a bunch of dudes' asses. I was like, ah, fair enough. Okay. There's the balance, I suppose, if you're going to get that. Like you say, exposition all over the place. So now we know, like, if you want anything in this world, you have to do at least 2 years in the military, which it's insane to think that that is probably going to be a possibility. Maybe not in our generation, but certainly in the next two or three, possibly, if things could keep going as they're going, which is just insane. From that point onwards, where are we? Essentially,
I feel like the major convergent point there is Carmen breaks up with Johnny.
Yes.
After like Diz just shows that she's a badass. Carmen breaks up with Johnny, and then they do a live fire exercise at the training camp where Johnny's in charge, and it's another little thing. You've been preconditioned that the bugs are the enemy. Bugs aren't the enemy. Because when they're doing a live fire exercise, who are they shooting against? People.
Yep.
So Johnny's put in charge of the squad during this live fire exercise where they've got real ammunition for some reason, and they're being shot at by like little cardboard cutouts with like laser guns. Someone gets shot with a laser gun and in turn seizes up, shoots this dude in the head, and you get like the first real practical effects, but like a gruesome ass death. And what's the first thing Johnny says? Because all he's heard from everyone else when something bad happens in this military, the first thing he calls for after a dude gets shot in the face is medic.
Yeah. That's the ongoing theme with Johnny, is he doesn't seem to have an original thought. Mm. Everything he does going forward, or seems to go on, is all stuff he's picked up in a scene previous with that medic bit.
He gets the ultimatum from Mike from Breaking Bad and Clancy Brown, where it's like, well, here's the thing, Johnny, you can either leave, take your stroller down Washout Lane, or take 10 lashes. And Johnny takes 10 lashes. And despite the fact he takes his whipping, he still wants to leave. Little thing we've missed here, because it convergence points of storytelling. Carmen's gone to the Fleet Academy. She's one of the craziest pilots out there. Wild bitch. And is ending up flying a starship next to Xander. Xander's also a flight commander. And he said this weird thing where he implies that he's like, oh, I did everything I could when I found that there was a crazy pilot coming out of Buenos Aires. I did anything I could to be their co-pilot. Whatever. It's very weird. Love triangle.
Mm-hmm. Love triangles, like a star.
Yeah.
Right, one of the more unsettling bits in that moment with the lashings, and it's supposed to be subversion, I suppose, but it was just like watching it, and it was a black man doing the lashing, which I suppose is subverting obviously the slavery in our past, in our world's past as well.
I never considered that, but that's a interesting way to view it.
So it was, again, it wasn't labored on, but seeing also, a black man lashing a white man, it was like, oh, this is
redemption.
This is different. Yeah, it's just like I said, this whole film for me was just an unsettling watch.
Also, Mike's arms look weird in that scene. Just again, if you watch it back, his arms look weirdly long. I don't like it.
There's just so many I don't know what the word is, but there's so many inconsistencies in parts that you just go, ah, this, it, I think it helps with the like dystopian weirdness about it, is that there is this little bit of inconsistency and changes where your brain's going, that's not quite right when I saw it last and all that kind of stuff.
Part of Xander and Carmen, an asteroid appears out of nowhere because Carmen's changed routes. An asteroid's coming at them. Oh, shit. They end up crashing into the asteroid, saving the ship, but as Johnny Rico is leaving, taking a stroll down Washout Lane, chaos ensues. People are running. He runs to his man, Kitten. Kitten delivers the line of the film, running for his life, with his heart and soul, with his full chest, screams, "War! We're going to war!" And it turns out Buenos Aires has been wiped off the map by a meteor. They say comes from the bug planet Glendafu.
The Buenos Aires thing, that took me off guard.
Yeah. White people in Buenos Aires, isn't there?
Yeah, I was like going, hang on, wait, what? Are they, how, what? Why is
the Buenos, Latin paradise.
Why is Buenos Aires being brought into this? This is, no, again, not right. Is this before, hang on, where are we with, is it after they go to war, they get the tattoos, or just before? Yeah.
Right. No, it's before they go to war, they get the tattoos whilst they're on the major ship. But right. it's for Buenos Aires has been hit by a meteor, and Dizzy's given the old, that's us, Johnny, that's us. Our home has been wiped off the earth. He gets a phone call, just before he gets a phone call from his parents, and the signal goes a bit fuzzy. So there's this little moment of like, there's a looming danger, but we don't know what it is. And it turns out the meteorite, we assume the meteorite that the ship dodged and knocked out their comms array, has crashed into Earth and just wiped Buenos Aires off the map. And they say it's a bug meteorite from Glendafu,
which is we got the interjects here. So every so often when there was like a new act for whoever's listening to this was already seen the film, but every so often there was, when like the next act begins, there's these infomercial kind of things. Do you want to know more? All that kind of stuff. Or would you like to know more?
I think you mean propaganda.
Yeah, but there was one, I think it was around about this one, that had the bit with all the kids stomping on the cockroaches to help the cause.
And who wants a fully automatic Merida? Who wants to hold it? And all the kids are like, I want the gun, I want the gun. And they're stomping on the cockroaches because the bugs are the enemy now. And the mom's like,
So, but at this point, for us, we've not been told why the bugs are the enemy, really. We've been told that they are the enemy, and we've seen that.
They are the enemy. And we know that they're dangerous because there's that scene where it kills the cow. And we know how to kill them because you shoot them in the nerve stem. And funnily enough, it's Neil Patrick Harris working in military intelligence who tells us that. Shoot them in the nerve stem and it'll go down in 5 shots.
Yeah, which nobody seems to really follow from going forward. They'll just like shoot the shit out of it until hopefully they hit something. Which is it the nerve stem or is it something else? We don't know. We just have to assume that military intelligence is right.
But now, the fleet's been militarized. Everyone is going to Glendafu, the bug home planet. Big K, as the ground troops are calling it. And we get the most epic... Well, actually, first off, going back to the team drama, Rico finds out that Carmen's now seeing Xander. And they pull him away. There's a little brawl. Pull away. And Carmen... Oh, Carmen, she's a little fucking... Oh, where's that? Wait. Oh, she's a fucking... Oh, she's a devil. She's a devil. She's like, I'm really happy to see you, Johnny. But you don't seem happy to see me. And he's like, oh, should I be?
Why would you? Why would you be happy? It's like, I don't... I'm going to give Denise Richards some credit here. She played... like, not clueless, but oblivious very well, because she didn't seem to, she's kind of teasing them at the start, not wanting to really kiss in front of their friends, and then all this bits of, oh, you're not really happy to see me. It's like, of course he's not happy to see you. Why would he be? This is why he's in the military, for God's sake, and you know, so it's...
And that's where they get their sick tattoos, death from above, let's all get cut together. It was on my first set of trunks.
Oh, all right. Is this the... Oh, just the death from above.
Yeah, wait, no, I don't think it was actually on the trunks. I think it was on my first set, like the first draft I sent to Vic Stitch, that like Death from Above logo where the Nightwing logo would have gone.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was it, because I was like, oh, yeah. I've considered it, but I'm like, no, because it is just, like, I may as well just get a swastika tattooed on me.
There is that. There is that connotation. I suppose for anyone who hasn't seen the film, then, I know there is very Nazi-ish when you look back at it.
Yeah, it's got like the lightning bolts in the triangle and the skull face.
It just says,
a shame. It's just a shame because it actually rips, man. Like, and I assume that there's people out there with it. It's not like it is not a fascist tattoo, but it is like you're literally looking at things from a surface level. It's like someone like going, "Oh, mate, I want to dress like Tyler Durden. He's the baddie."
But yeah, there is a bit of an SS vibe to the tattoo. So that's. That's fair.
But they get the tattoo, the drop sequence. Come on, tell me you weren't hype for them to, like, go down there and just rip.
I mean, because that's what we've been preconditioned to expect, because we saw
the soundtrack.
The bit that Ace got my tits here, because he poured alcohol on the tattoo, that's just because I'm old. I looked at it and went, "Oh, you prick. I hope you die soon." And then he just never fucking died. So... we haven't mentioned it, but there's no doubt that he is abusey. We don't need a DNA test at all. That's pretty.
Your hand on that wall. Sorry, we cut over the best part where they're doing knife throwing. Training, and Ace goes, "Sir, I don't know why we're doing this. Oh God! Like, if you want to kill the enemy, all you have to do is push a button." And like, Clancy Brown goes, "Okay, put your hand on that wall. Put your hand on that wall." And like, Jake Busey puts his hand out and just throws a knife into his hand and goes, "The enemy cannot push a you cannot push a button if you disable the enemy's hand," and then takes the knife out and then calls for a medic.
And then, of course, but then that's a callback to later on in the film with Denise Richards with the brain. So there you go. There's I noticed things. In this one watch, I've got things that I've not touched my notes, except I really didn't really write many. It was like, "Oh my God, this guy's in it. This guy's in it. Oh my God, this guy's in it."
Oh, that's crazy.
It was amazing. So we've got the Planet K. I was a year in. We're now back to the start of the film.
Yeah. Get to see the plasma bugs.
We did. We got to see Ace shit the bed, and Johnny is, of course, the hero that directs the team.
Well, before he shits the bed, the first thing that happens, as soon as the ground troopers have like hit the ground, they nuke these massive bugs that are shooting plasma. It's random light, random light is perfectly fine until it starts burning up ships, and it's like, oh, that's not random light. Someone made a mistake. Someone made a big goddamn mistake. So not only are the ground troopers going into action, but there's action happening up in space as well.
Mm-hmm.
But they land on the planet. The first thing that happens, their squad leader just gets murked right away. Just first thing that happens. And then they're like, "Ace, what do we do?" "I don't know." And then Johnny Rico, as you say, jumps right into action. Kill him all. Sajumi, our man, our Filipino king, gets a little bit overzealous. He starts doing "Come on, you want some? Yeah, some for you." And just gets obliterated. Gets turned to ash. All these characters that you've built up to know within this boot camp scene,
mm-hmm.
murked in the most vicious way.
I'm of the thought you say that someone's made a big fucking mistake and like that kind of thing, and we don't know what these lights are. If this has been an enemy that they've been aware of for so long, then surely someone must have known about these lights things being actual things. So. And I think it was said later that the infantry is pretty much a suicide squad. They're there to die.
Expendable, yeah.
Yeah, expendable. So makes me think, was that mission again propaganda to go, well, these, because it was, because a bit afterwards saying 10,000, 100,000 killed. Was that all just a ploy to have that headline?
Yeah. Or was it Vietnam where they went, "Oh yeah, we'll just chop her into the jungle and and they just all get murked because they're going onto home territory."
Mm-hmm.
And another little thing, cinematically, the way that the mobile infantry move around Klyndafu, almost like insects.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was no actual like plan. It seemed it was all just run and running gun, which is fine if you're the front lot, but you can't gun if you're the one next, but in the couple rows behind.
I feel that it is just kind of like I think looking at it from a military industrial complex kind of thing, it's like, cool, we're going to pay all this money to get all this equipment. We're going to go in there. We're going to smash the entire area. We're going to destroy the bug home planet. Oh, God. Turns out there's more of them and we don't know how to kill them.
Mm-hmm.
So then Johnny Rico gets killed.
Yep, and there's a little line that says that 100,000 dead, but there's none wounded.
3 minutes, yeah.
And Carmen says there's never any wounded.
Yeah,
and that was
MIA KIA.
Yeah, so that was and then said, oh, but they never keep them, or the bugs don't keep them prisoner. And then we see Johnny waking up in a cryogen thing, getting his leg all fixed up. And there was a weird point, this point. I thought we were now into a totally different time. Like still the same time, but I thought there was a bigger gap than there was. Because then Dizzy kisses the side of the tank and all that. I'm like, are we now into a different, like, parallel universe where they actually got together in that moment? And it just, again, it fed into the inconsistency bit of going, why did that happen? Because they're not together, and they've already had the fallout where they're not liking each other, or at least Johnny doesn't like Dizzy anymore. It just, it was a weird thing. And then got the reveal: your man Ironside is actually Mr. Raznek is got his Raznek roughnecks.
Yeah. It turns out he's like an old veteran, but I guess the whole thing is like, so many people have been killed, but we need people. So they bring out all these old veterans, but like, suppose he must have been like in the reserves or whatever, because the whole thing is he just appeared on Klyndafu afterwards and just like swept up and saved all these people. And then he's got his ratchet roughnecks. So then now thing is like, so this like full military onslaught didn't work of us just going into the planet with run and gun. Let's carpet bomb the area and then let's clean house. So now we're going on to. The Outer Rims, pretty much they're going now to every planet around Klyndafu to go in. I can't remember what it's not Planet P is what it's called, but that's where Zegma Beach is. And Zegma Beach, I always wanted to go there. Good luck, it's not there anymore, and that's where we get Sugar Watkins. We get like the two badass characters with like the little chains around the neck.
Mm-hmm.
Who do you think saved your ass? And they go into Planet P, and you get to see that Sugar Watkins is a little unhinged and commits a war crime. Because they neutralize the bug, and then he just keeps.
Yeah, so they just keep going, and.
Just a little thing for foreshadowing of our conversation later on. And again, you'll appreciate this line if you've watched this film. Our man, Ratchek, drops the line of. I have one rule. Everyone fights. No one quits. If you don't do your job, I'll shoot you myself. Do you get me?
We got you, sir.
Welcome to the Roughnecks. Ratchet's Roughnecks! Huh.
Yeah, so they're into Planet P. Sorry, I wasn't expecting the dab. We're into Planet P and we're finding out that, or we have found out that they're looking for a hive mind, a brain of some description, but they don't know what they're looking for.
A brain? Sorry. Brain bugs? Frankly, I find the idea of a bug that thinks offensive.
So we get that, and then we get to see some brain sucking. We get to see the aftermath of a brain sucking.
Before that, we see the tanker bug. So on this...
Bit of a ropey SFX. That was one that was like...
It still almost holds up in comparison to other things. This is 1997, though.
Yeah, that's the thing I always bear in mind, going, CGI great, in general, because it is 1987. So I always give that a little star.
But yeah, we essentially get the tanker bug, which just spits acid, and Johnny takes it down single-handedly, jumping on his back, shooting it out, drops a grenade in it, boom. And then Ratchet's like, oh, where'd you learn how to do that? And Johnny's like, oh, you're my dad figure now. I was the captain of the team. He's like, oh, cool. Very well. Well, now I've lost one of my squad leaders. Rico, you're next in line.
That's the other thing. Like, Rico never... It's that thing where he picks up things as he goes along from other figures and then uses it as his own. But yeah, he never actually like applies for any of these positions. He does something heroic and then goes, well, you've got the job.
Kind just falls up the ladder.
Yeah, and well, he wants to pick...
And what's the line? It's like, you're it. I think it's like he needs a new lieutenant or new sergeant. He's like, you're it until you're dead or you can't do it.
Mm-hmm. And there was a bit where it was that point where he's trying to... Well, he was going to pick Ace as he's...
Yeah, he's like...
And I'm watching it going...
Yeah, he's like, Ace, can you be my man? And he's like, oh, nah, I screwed it up on Big K. So then he asks Dizzy, and Dizzy's like, yeah, and then they do that concussion headbutt.
And at that point, I was thinking, if this was real life, obviously none of it is yet. She's literally standing there knowing that she's the second pick, which is her role anyway, because he already picked Carmen. And
well, there you go.
Second pick.
Always the second pick. And then... Night after that, we get another little thing where Ratchet's like, hey, here's a beer, here's the entertainment. I expect the best, and I give you the best. So he gets some beer, gets some football, gets some a violin, you know? And then we get more boob.
Two of them. Wonderful.
Yeah. We get the awkward Spider-Man kiss where Johnny's like, let me cover your face. And
that was weird.
I'll pretend it's Carmen.
That was what I was getting from that. And it was just watching it. It looked so super awkward with it. She was like that, and
yeah,
that's where I was thinking it was he's thinking it's Carmen,
and then Dizzy drops the "I love you," and Johnny gives a very stilted "I love you."
Yeah, because
earlier, "I love you," he didn't get back.
That's
from
it,
Carmen. Oh, it's so rough. It's like, "I love you, Carmen." Say it back. Try it on for size, and she gives him a.
There's so like right. I'm now swinging into the more. I'm enjoying the film now that I'm speaking to someone about it, because there is so many like things that the foreshadowing in the opening bit that's then being brought back and brought through and all that kind of stuff. So find out there is a brain.
There's an outpost that's causing a distress call. It's like, cool, let's go prep it. It's a hotel Delta or whatever. Out there, we also find that it's flying bugs. There's flying bugs, and we see that Ratchet lives by his motto. Oh, this guy can't fulfill his destiny. He's a radio guy. Boom, one in the chest. I expect anyone to do the same for me. They get to the outpost. It's been murked. Human bodies lying everywhere. And this leads up to the greatest scene. But before that, we get the crazy sergeant who tells us there's like, he says, finally, they got into his mind. They made him do the distress signal. And you see, there's literally... Michael Ironside puts his fingers in a dude's brain and it's disappeared. Mm-hmm. And I always used to do that to jam donuts, you know? Little sugary jam donuts, little, like, they sucked his brains out.
At this point, I was expecting the jittery sergeant, I was expecting his head to explode at some point. I was expecting just something to come out of it, you know?
Yeah.
But he ended up just getting squashed the fuck by a big flying bug.
Well, again, a great part is like, oh my god, we don't have a lifeboat right now, or we're gonna die. Control yourself. I can't. I wish you'd just shoot me. And he just said that to the wrong person because Ratchet cocks his shotgun. I was like, hey, come on. He's mental. And then bugs. And I think this is a scene that video games have been trying to recapture for the longest period of time, because this is the flood, you know, this is the moment. This is World War Z. This is essentially they're holed up in an outpost with countless insurmountable odds coming against them in bugs. And after they kill one, the next one just piles on top of it. It was an ambush. And it's just such a prominent scene. And you've got the towers with their miniguns. You've got essentially the little bullet clicks as well every time someone cocks. And I think it's the best actions. Just that little shot of the... I don't know what the fucking mechanic is called right now. But essentially just like pulling the trigger and the cock goes. And you just see all these rounds disappearing and flying out. And just the odds become insurmountable. They have to recede back into the outpost. We've now got inside the outpost. That's crazy. Well, I hope you have a crazy pilot. All the bugs are climbing in. Now you see people get murked as soon as they're forced to retreat back in from these walls. Even people who are jumping away, they're getting murked out of midair. You've got the flying bugs absolutely just like sawing people's heads off. It's like, ooh, wow, that must have been an accident. No, a bomb. Second one. Heads coming clean off. Ace shoots one of them and it falls into our mental lad, and he gives him a little smirk of
like, oh well, kind of thing. But yeah, the mention of the crazy pilot, so you know who's coming from that point onwards, and the thing comes down and Xander comes out.
Ibanez, she's crazy, literally set up.
Yeah, it was a bit of all the things that is in this film that you could go, it's a bit sledgehammery. That was probably the most sledgehammer of the sledgehammer. Right, that he could go. We need someone crazy, and look at it's Carmen and Xander.
Yeah.
Suddenly in a rescue pod kind of thing, and they've usually just been in these big ships.
Yeah, big drop ships. Yeah.
Which made me think that after Johnny died, quote unquote, that Carmen may have went. She was still the career girl, but she wanted to save people instead, because Johnny died. Kind of thing. That was my kind of thinking instead.
Dude, again, like, speaking to you, I never considered that. That's great. Yeah, like that could be, but that's the catalyst. But then we get that just all hope is lost. Something bursts out the ground, swollen in Michael Ironside, and it pull him out the ground. His legs are gone, and then Johnny has to do it, Rico. You know what to do. And he has to kill his father figure, shooting him one in the chest. Out of the ground bursts a tanker bug. If a tanker bug is right there next to them, what are they going to do? Our hero, Dizzy, pops one grenade in the mouth, blows its head off. Perfect. And within 10 seconds, it goes from celebration, the horns are somewhere. Slow motion cut, Johnny Rico, Dizzy! And we see that there's a warrior bug right behind her. Impales her, 1, 2, 3. Dragging a body out where Ace and Johnny coming into the rescue, but she's been impaled. They get her onto the retrieval boat. Our man Xander, literally holding him off with his own little assault rifle. And he's like, come on, Tower, let's go. The two guys and the little stationary guns who must have been like holding off the tidal wave, you know, slide down the tower, but they don't make it to the ship. They get melted by a second tanker bug and they fly off into space, and we get the most, again, it's an awkward ass death scene, but it's blood, it's gory. And I said this on a podcast I once did about Starship Troopers. I said this on a podcast I once did. I think it's absolutely rough that Dizzy's last line on Earth is, I'm dying, but that's okay, because at least we shagged.
Yeah, and that's...
Well, I mean, she says, at least I got to have you, meaning kind of like, have you...
Which again, falls into that theory is, did she join the military just to get to Johnny? Because if that's her last words, that's... Yeah, that falls into that theory of, she joined just...
Although her last words are, oh my God, Johnny, don't let me go. And it's just rough. I can still hear her in the back of my head, but man, yeah. And then Xander comes up forward, Carmen's there, he says, your friend Rico's back there, and then he has a realization. He comes up, he's like, right, what's going on here? And Carmen's like, I thought you were dead. And it's like, yeah, I'm not, but a lot of people are.
I know, the smell of fart acting, I felt in that moment as well. Mm. But no, he's fallen into another promotion because Raznek's
now
gone.
Superseded, yeah. So now that the fleet is mobilized, why are they mobilized? We need to destroy that planet. It's like, well, no, because we're going elsewhere. And at Dizzy's funeral, Neil Patrick Harris shows up in his nasty garb, and he explains that it's like, well, that outpost mission was actually a ploy to just work out, is there a brain bug? And then, I think Rico does the line of, MI does the flying. MI does the dying, fleet does the flying. Great line. Yeah. But then, like, he's speaking, essentially, they've been reunited. Carmen, Johnny, and
Carl. Terrible name. Again, Scottish accent.
Yeah, very German name. and they're just talking. And it's like, well, we're going back to P to capture that brain. And it's like, so the more people are going to die. That's what the mobile infantry is good for.
Mm-hmm.
Fresh meat for the grinder.
Well, I was noticing every time you see Neil Patrick Harris' character again, like the gaunter he becomes more grey and like darkened around the eyes and stuff like that, which again helps with the kind of just evil motif with the whole black uniform as well, which was a nice little I would say it was subtle. Every time you saw him, that's the more gaunter he became as well, which
grim, yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, they're going back.
Going back, and now it's Rico's roughnecks, but they're all kids. Which they make a joke about at the start of the film. Young people all around the world are joining the mobile infantry. I'm doing my part! I'm doing my part!
I did
I'm
write
doing
that.
My part.
I finally got the meme from what was it? What's it called again?
I think you should leave.
That's the one. I binged that whole.
I didn't do fucking shit.
Yeah, that was my first thought when I was watching it, going, oh, and then I went, I did fucking shit. I was like, this is from.
So that part, like, it cuts out the actual punchline of that scene anyway, which is the kid going, I'm doing my part too, and everyone going, a kid, that's crazy. And then it's literally like these kids are all like 13, and they're kitted up for an invasion.
Yeah, he's acting like the vet, and we don't know what the timeline is between him starting and this mission
weeks.
Taking place. But yeah, it
probably
feels
weeks.
Like weeks, because
yeah,
just going mission, here they are. Which so again, that's insane. And obviously all the things he's saying is all stuff he's picked up from his superiors
Ratchet,
beforehand,
yeah.
Ratchet and I did it right down, Clancy Brown.
Yeah.
So it's all just stuff he's just repeating verbatim, no change to cadence either, so it's all literally just word for word, and now he's in charge of a whole
squad. Rico's roughnecks.
So they go back to P, and
well, they're already there, and
yep.
Then another catastrophe happens in space, because that's the catalyst, because they're already on the planet, like at the start they're like, oh, the plasma's going off, they know we're here.
Yeah.
So they're just like, they're trying to scan for this brain bug wherever it is. It's somewhere underground, but they don't know where it is. So they're trying to track it down. They're going out in all these different squads. But plasma fire, it's destroying the ships up in space. And it turns... there's a fake out with Carmen earlier, but they've actually hit it. And Carmen's ship is going down, exploding into a million pieces, tiny bodies everywhere. Her captain, which... Captain Delardinley, great, like... For every scene that she's in, she commands the scene.
Mm-hmm.
She's got to carry on, and then dies in just the most brutal way.
I mean, I noticed that, like, the deaths and that they were brutal, but they weren't like hurt. Like, they weren't like scary at the same time, you know, because it was all very obvious practical effects. Which now again, we're in 2024, so we can see practical effects a bit better than you could in 1997, when it was just smaller TVs and less pixels. But yeah, even though the deaths were gruesome, you still got to see all the bodies charred and all that kind of about. Because I think it's because it's been upscaled so much now in 2024.
Yeah.
it didn't, it probably had more of an impact when you were watching it back in the 90s. Back in the early 2000s. But yeah, still, the practical effects were still pretty
So, like, they escape on a little escape pod, which is like a little two-person seater thing that they get shot out of the ship within seconds. But there's one, the people next to them, as soon as they're trying to, like, go out on the, like, the escape pod thing, their thing gets diverted and they crash into the side. So it's just these little sad things. And, like, damn, those are two people that, like, just didn't make it just by chances of what was happening.
Mm-hmm.
But that, again, is another brutal thing in which they're flying through space and there's just bodies just...
Just smacking the thing. So then Carmen and Xander, they kind of crash land. There's this weird bit
into the middle of Bug City. There's a little radio call. Johnny hears it. Carmen, is that you, Carmen? But the signal's bad. She can't. Situation is extremely hostile, and they have to hold themselves off. But it's just like one person versus one bug. It's not even equal potentially, but it's not equal. Two people versus multiple bugs? Nah, they get sweeped. Xander gets stabbed in the ass. Carmen gets stabbed in the shoulder. But Xander was smart enough. I'm going to get a knife. I'm going to get a knife before. And then the reveal.
Big brain.
So Johnny, like, okay, we need to stick to mission. This was Johnny's first thing that he like decided, like, because I think Sugar Watkins goes, "You heard the man. Rescue party!" And Johnny goes, "No, we can't. We need to stick to the mission. I'm a mission man now. I can do this. I can do it without her." So then they go, like, they go down to do their mission. We meet the brain bug. And use your words, use your verbiage to describe the brain bug.
Brain bug is cute as fuck. It was a big brain, but it had really big, cute eyes, you know? Which, again, helps with the theory of, are the bugs the bad guys? Because it would just looked so cute and that. I mean, it, disgustingly big brain, but...
Yeah. It looked like it's a spider with a vagina mouth that a massive penis comes out from, but and cute. It sucks your brain out. Like, but in a cute
way.
But, yeah. Oh, come here, you little...
But it was just the white, just the big pupils kind of thing. It was just like, how is that the enemy? You know, and then it sucks the brain out of Xander, which was very fucking gruesome.
Oh no! But before it sucks the brain out of Xander, because it unveils its little tendril for brain sucking, and it's gonna happen anyway. But Xander delivers, and hey man, Xander's a dick. And maybe he's a dick in a 90s sense, in which I don't think he is purposefully a dick. I think he has dickish behaviors, but he's not a complete and total villain.
Mm-hmm.
He's like that dude in, you know, like Not Another Teen Movie. You know, he's like, oh, he's a bit of an asshole, but he's not a bad guy. And this literally turns me around on him. It doesn't turn me around on him, but I think it's badass.
Mm-hmm.
It shouldn't be badass because it is totally just like xenophobic. But he's like primed, and this thing's gonna suck his brain out, and he goes, "One day, someone like me is going to kill you and your whole fucking race." And he spits at the thing before getting his brain sucked out in the most gruesome way. And just the last thing you see, his gaunt, washed out face, his eyes rolling into the back of his head. Gah. So it's just like proper, just like chewed on him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and then
so now I've got...
Oh, I'm in between this. So before we get to that position, I believe, we get Johnny Rico walking through the tunnels, and there's like a little split in the rows, and he goes, "Mission's that way, but Carmen's down there." He's like, "How do you know?" He's like, "Don't know. I just know it is. I sense it." It's like, "Well, hey, you can get court-martialed for going off mission." So they split up. They go, "Okay, cool. Ace, Sugar Watkins, we'll go with you. But rest of the team, go the usual path. Try find them." So that's happening. They've split off. Denise Richards is going to get her brain sucked out. It's ready. It's prime of a ritual. She's been given the knife from Xander earlier. She cuts the little brain sucky part. It starts spewing out little things. Then all of a sudden, before the warrior bugs attack, out of nowhere, Johnny Rico, You know what this is? Holding a nuke in his hand. You know what this is? You're some kind of smart bug, aren't you? And they rescue. They rescue Denise Richards as the brain bug recedes into the injured, cowering way into the warrior bugs. And the warrior bugs go on full on assault. And they have to back out. Gunfire raining everywhere. It's four people versus a mass of bugs. Unfortunately, it doesn't work out. They hold him off, but it doesn't work out for Sugar Watkins, who takes one slash right across. And once again, another heroic self-sacrifice, bruv. I love films of self-sacrifice, and it's probably because of Starship Troopers. Sugar Watkins saying, give me the nuke. Give me the nuke. Johnny's like, you're trying to be a hero? I'm just trying to kill some bugs. Because he has a hatred for bugs. And he holds that nuke close to his chest, tells him, get out of here. Holding them off one by one with a little gun with the scope. For some reason, he's the only dude with a scope. Holding that nuke together as it like beeps faster, faster, faster. He's like, yeah, you want that? You like that? Oh, you want some more? Yeah, come on. Get some. Blow up a nuke. The heroes are saved. You know, our classic heroes, Johnny, Carmen, and Ace. He's there as well. His teeth blocked the blast.
Something like, again, we're talking a lot about mirroring and all that kind of stuff. It seems that Ace, tall, blonde, Aryan. It mirrors the dynamic of the three of them anyway, because Carl was that tall, blonde, Aryan that they had in their threesome of thruple?
Friend group.
Yeah, friend group. So of course that's going to be the dynamic at the end as well. That's going to be the three of them. They all look kind of the same in that kind of respect as well. Even though I think Ace is absolutely useless and I wanted to die really quickly.
So paint us into the next scene. So they've just escaped that nuclear blast.
So they come out and then it's all the wars. Well, the brain bug's been captured.
Yeah.
By Clancy Brown, who's now a private.
Yeah. Oh, before we find out who captured the brain, we get the reveal. We finally caught the brain. Military intelligence.
Oh,
get hit.
Yeah, this was, yeah.
Carl, yeah.
Super, super Nazi-ish.
Carl puts the hand on the brain bug. Cute little, you know, your cute little eyes pulsating. And Carl gives the, it's afraid. Yeah, guns firing at me. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, we got him, yeah. Guys in the club going up to women being like, it's afraid. But yeah, and then they catch up with Carl. Carl, it was you. It was you who told me where Carmen was. He's like, oh, that's classified.
Mm-hmm. Wink,
and
wink.
Listen. We got the brain. And it wasn't the Mighty Fleet. It wasn't the Mobile Infantry. It was a drill instructor named Zim. And it turns out that Zim has taken a forced demotion from training troopers to be the hero of the movie. Zim got the bug.
I think you're absolutely right, especially that scene with the I'm afraid everyone's going, yeah, big, cute, ugly things, afraid. If you took out that first scene, the humans are the bad guys. Like, absolute that they're the bad guys. But with that
again,
scene,
that first scene, that first 2 minutes of the film, it tells you we've just landed on what the ground troops are calling Big K. It's an ugly planet. It's a bug planet, a planet with hostile. And the first thing that happens is a bug comes around a corner and kills this reporter because it's imagining like a military coming into your house and you come around the corner with a frying pan and kill one person.
Mm-hmm.
That's what that was. The bugs aren't good guys. I'm not saying that because they are brutal and like messed up. They are just as bad as the good as like yeah. But they are just the same but different tact. They are just trying to work out. They want to know us so they can kill us in the same way. But that's what the mobile infantry are trying to do. That is a quote from the mental like lieutenant that they find in the freezer. They want to know us. They want to know how we think. They want to know us so they can kill us.
Other than the meteor, which is quite a big one, do the bugs ever instigate a fight?
So there was a Mormon colony in one of the news reports. There's a Mormon colony, but that was the Mormons that put an outpost on their on a bug planet and then just got murked.
Mm-hmm.
But that wasn't them. I mean, that was Mormons landing on their planet and them going, we're insects. Fuck you.
Yeah. So, but still, humans have invaded their territory. So the bugs have went, well, you've invaded our territory. Get out. Yeah. Kind of thing. Yeah. I don't, again,
so, we'll get to the film and then let's get into the politics. So once they've said, we've captured the brain, and now it's like, well, guess what? The war isn't over. Now that we've got the brain, we're going to experiment on it. We're going to improve our weapons. We're going to improve our ships. And we will fight until we win.
End of movie.
And then you see, like, Johnny Rico's now a hero of the Federation. We see the Carmen's now, like, soldiers like Ace Levy. You can be, like, a soldier. Soldier like Ace Levy. Soldier like Lieutenant Johnny Rico. And, like, Carmen Urbanez, who is now in the position of Captain Dunlade. They will fight. What's the quote? It's they will fight and they will win. What's the, like, I need to look this up because it's very specific for this. But pretty much, the war isn't over. The hero of the movie isn't actually the hero of the hero of the war that we're seeing. He is just someone that who has been. It's someone once described this film or once described this film. I say I saw it on a TikTok that Starship Troopers is what to white guys what Midsommar is. For women who've just gone through a breakup.
Right. Okay.
And if you've not seen Midsommar, you've not seen Midsommar. But essentially, Midsommar is a breakup movie that by the end of it, you're like, wow, I'm happy that her boyfriend, who is a bit of a dick, but isn't a bad guy, is getting burnt to death in a shed.
Okay. So yeah, we'll get the quote up and then we'll do your, I don't know, the aftermath, the final thoughts.
Go through your final thought, because I'm going to see if I think this is a very niche quote to find.
Yeah. Well, pretty much, after, like, when I started this review, this chat about it, going that I didn't know if I liked this film, but I want to watch it again. And after speaking to you through it, I'm still a little bit in the camp of, I still don't know if I like this film. But I'm now stronger in the opinion of I need to watch it again because I don't feel that for a lot of films. Like I love Marvel films. I'll watch Marvel films over and over again, but I don't have a lot of films where I'll go, I have to see this at some again. I have to watch it again at some point. I have to take time to do that because that's just never been my thing. But this film's up there with going, I must have missed a lot in this film because of that feeling afterwards going, something doesn't feel right about this film because of something. And after speaking to you about it, I was right in that thought, but there's so many other little things that you could probably pick up again with a second, third, or for yourself, 40th watch. Yeah. It's just, I'm glad
the quote keep fighting and they will win.
Yeah, it's so vague, isn't it?
Yeah.
But it's so, like, if you told Americans that, they would go batshit crazy for it and put on bumper stickers. You know, it's that kind of military propaganda vagueness that you could put out there.
Yeah. So I initially enjoyed this film as a kid from the like blinded standpoint of, oh, this film's so sick.
Mm-hmm.
And it is sick. It is proper sick. But then there's this underlying message that is just kind of like, corrupt. Mm-hmm. You know,
I'm glad this is a couple of times every time we've kind of arranged these chats you've put Starship Troopers forward and we've ended up not doing it. We did with the gold member last time because I'd already watched it millions of times. I'm glad that you've persevered with Starship Troopers as a choice, because it's definitely a film that I've watched. But it's just,
and I think a sad part about it is you'll never be able to watch it for the first time again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because this is a film I didn't look at my phone or anything during this. Again, another sign of a film that kind of dragged me in, and now I still want to see it again is because I didn't look at my phone, I didn't do any of that kind of shit. I had a little notepad that I stopped locked writing. I barely wrote anything.
What was the last note you got?
I put Rico imitates commando. Imitates commands. That's it.
So you were just locked in for that final sequence.
Pretty much. I got like little bits here. I got right. This are all my notes. They're not very good, but
also one. Rico does the flip 6-3 hole in the training when we're doing the laser guns. And also, I have wanted to do that as a kid, like laser guns, but you get shot. Hell yeah.
You can still throw it in a match at some point. I don't know how, but there's ways. So I've written down, this is all my notes, so it didn't really go well. 997, CGI great in general. I'm doing my part meme, flashback, MPH, exclamation mark, Denise Richards, Rico typical jock type, Clancy Brown, TCW, Tasty Coma Wife. Of course, the girl plays Jamie in what the fuck's it called? With Ryan Reynolds in it. Christmas film. Can't remember. Anyway, she's in it. She's the other pilot. With Carmen. Dean Norris. Tattoo. Ace was rubbish. Planet P. Trap. Dizzy dies. Buenos Aires. 2 question marks.
Yeah. Why are you that deep into a film and you go, wait a minute.
That's the bit that confused me the most in the whole film. Return. Carmen escapes. Killed, question mark, then scratched out, captured. Xander brain sucked, brain captured. Neil Patrick Harris, Nazi vibe. Rico imitates commands. That is all my notes for this film.
Because he drops with the, come on, you apes, you want to live forever.
Yeah, so that's all I've got. And the rest of it, thankfully, you've filled in the gaps with the timeline of the film because it's burned in your brain forever. But yeah, as... Is this a film you've recommended to others? Have they kind of had this kind of
as soon as anything in relation to it comes up, I'm like, bro, you need to watch it. And if you've not watched it, let's get some pizza and let's watch it. It's like, again, it's one of my favorites. It's literally my number one. Like, again, even just from a standpoint of like being able to turn my brain off and being like, cool, like the outpost scene, mint, Klandafu scene. Mint, like all the training stuff is like, it's like that Full Metal Jacket, but like somehow worse. There's the like the bro kind of like comedy, you know, like Ace, like he's that little like, oh yeah, come on, I'm a sucker. Like the like Sugar Watkins sacrifice at the end, the one day someone like me is gonna kill you and your whole fucking race. The quotes, you know, war, we're going to war.
It's
Zegama Beach.
I would say that if anyone ever brings this film up to me, I would say watch it at least once, maybe twice. Watch it twice, at least, because
I want to tell someone, watch this film from this point onwards.
Yeah. So just go from the 1 year earlier.
Yeah,
that's it. Go from there. Because I, you're absolutely right. If that scene wasn't there, it's a total different film.
Because, again, if you want to talk about the bug meteor, right, it went halfway across a galaxy. Halfway across a galaxy and landed on Earth. Did it? Or did a pilot change their course, collide with a meteorite... That just happened to be from a bug planet, collided into a meteorite, knocked that meteor out of its path, bong bong, meteor goes to Earth.
I mean, do we ever actually see it was a meteor? We just hear it is. We just see the aftermaths of it. Is there to say that there was
I mean, there was the looming thing of like,
mm-hmm. But yeah, that could, meteor, that, but that hey, could be a like, bomb.
Again, yeah, it could be a bomb. It could, again, just be a, like, again, false flag. But, that's one of the major theories there is, like, I'm a bug truther, you know? Like, I don't think it was the bugs.
Mm-hmm. I, again, going back and speaking to you about it and that unsettlement feeling I had during the film, that was kind of my thinking as well, that this was all because of the propaganda bits in between, yeah. As well,
again, the propaganda in the first part initializes you that bug meteorites are coming from outer space, but now we have planetary defenses to stop them. Again, that already sets in your mind, it's a primer. bug have meteorites that they are sending to our planet. Cut that out. We see a meteorite comes, gets knocked, goes into planet, and they say it's the bugs.
So what you're saying is you want the arachnid cut of this film?
I think the arachnid cut is without that primer at the start, mm-hmm. without the propaganda and without the newscast.
Yeah.
I think that's the arachnid cut.
Because if you, again, taking out the first scene absolutely changes the film, but if you take out the propaganda bits as well, it just, we're the humans are the bad guys. Full stop, yeah. The end. And I think now we can watch it in 2024, we're a little bit more attuned to that kind of propaganda stuff. Mm-hmm. Because we've been taught about it and what the Nazis did. I mean, what the home front did as well.
Well, literally, Paul Verhoeven like took direct inspiration from like Stasi and again, I don't think anyone's now listening to the podcast going, well, yeah, but like he took inspiration like almost like shot for shot from propaganda from World War II. Second part of it as well is the fact that everyone's just like bloody like Dawson's Creek looking ass. It's literally mm-hmm. just like, cool, let's get a bunch of handsome people for this, make it look like an advert for the military. And again, from a first watch, if you're not attuned to like propaganda and rhetoric, yeah, oh man, you military's so cool, you get to hang out with all your dudes and then like go to space and shoot guns, but oh wait, as soon as you land on a planet, you're just gonna get murked.
It's a fascinating film. So I thank you for bringing it into my life, and I'm going to be forever confused. Not forever confused, but forever going, I need to get 2 hours blocked out to watch this again so I can take it in more now that I'm going in with how it ends and watching it back at the start again.
Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no games, or games unlimited games but no games? That is from referee Lee Thomas. Gonna have to come back to me on this one, but I'll probably go with games, unlimited games, but no games. Do you do it for the love of the game? No, I do it for the love of the games, unlimited games, but no games. That is from Mark of the Year contender, Bry Guy. Cool dude. Joe asked me, what's Ligma? It's a serious issue. I don't want to talk about it right now. I don't want to bring the mood down. Kal-El, not
Superman's dad.
Krypton. No. Yeah. No, Kal-El is Superman. Sorry. Superman's dad. Jor-El.
Jor-El.
Superman's dad. Come on. It's like Frankenstein's monster, you know. Do you sing your own theme song? No. The theme song is sung by Elliot Stradling. He is a rapper from... he's not an Elgin, but pretty much Elgin. Near enough Elgin. Where is it? Not Huntley, between like Fockerbird's area.
Oh, that is really near. Okay, cool. I know that you've lived up here, but I was half expecting going, oh, it's near here, Thurso. And I'll be like,
yeah. But nah, he's like, he lived in like Fockerbird's, but he now lives in Glasgow. He's got a great band called The Rarely Social, but he also has a solo rap, couple of EPs out there. Elliot Stradling, look him up, incredible stuff, and also does Ian Skinner's theme song. What did I have on Instagram? Do you have any on your side of things?
I got one on Instagram, and I've got a bunch of
Twitter. We are doing quick fire questions here. Because we have talked for fucking...
I know, we're almost hitting Scotty Swift levels of podcasting here.
He got to talk about Ghostbusters, I got to talk about, you know, like...
I don't know, it's all fair.
Starship Troopers. Diet Coke is the worst Coke, and that's facts. I'm a champ, and my opinion is the only right one. Okay, Judas Grey. You didn't have to mention that you're the champ. Again, I don't like Diet Coke. I objectify Diet Coke.
That's the point. Yes. Everyone's missing the point in this.
Yes, and it happens every time. Penciled in Nikki, great fan from Sov Pro. Mm-hmm. Top 3 dream opponents for this year. Let's go Speedball, Mike Bailey, Mike Loku, and a wild card, someone up and coming. Let's talk Tony Wright. Tony Wright from Manchester, great guy. Little Cheddar. Also, I'd love to have a tag team match with Act 2. What is this? What is this dream opponent city? That's crazy.
What's this wrestling chat?
Just quick one. Quick permission to call you chat.
Okay.
Okay, chat. What questions do you have?
Right. So I've just got the one on Instagram, which is from our one to watch wrestler of the year, Rob Stowe. And he's given me a word I probably can't say. Does he miss Cervinos?
Chivarinos. Chivarinos in Edinburgh. Yes, I do. It's the sauce. Dude, if you're ever in Edinburgh, Chivarinos pizza.
I'm in Edinburgh at the end of April.
I'm yes, to our first I'm not there. Oh, and I'm not fuck. There. I know, right? Yeah, I'm in Wigan that day, 28th of April. I'm against Sandy Beach, Grand Pro Wrestling. And the day before that, I'm in UPW. Facing Jay Joshua in a pure rules match. Jay Joshua is incredible. He's sicker than the average. He's also the IPW Z-Force champion. Not IPW, IWN Z-Force champion.
Well, that's pissed on my cornflakes. I thought I was going to get to see you live again. That's all right. But no, first time going to disco. I'm buzzing, absolutely buzzing.
It'll be great. You get to see Joe Henry versus Leon Slater.
Yes. I'm going to see Hamilton the day before. So that's the payoff weekend.
The small little city outside of Glasgow, it's not that much to look for.
Yeah, so at Hamilton.
Oh, come on. Okay.
That went over my head. Sorry.
Okay. Oh, did you get that on Amazon standard shipping?
It's 10 to 10. I don't. Yeah. This is way past my bedtime.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. 10 to 10. Cool. What's the next question, mate?
Anyway, come on, right. Okay. Roncello. Story. Oh, that's a bigger one. We'll ask the easy questions first. What's the first movie you remember seeing at the cinema?
Oh, dude, first one that I have a distinct memory of is either The Santa Claus or Toy Story 2.
Oh, yes, Toy Story 2 is mine.
I remember also seeing Monsters, Inc. And I was scared that we were going to see Lord of the Rings because Lord of the Rings had the ring race in it and I was kind of spooked out by him at the time.
Yeah. Favorite cinema snack?
Sweet popcorn or Maltesers or Starmix Haribo. Like it depends on kind of like the day, but mainly I'll go with a sweet popcorn and a large Coke Zero with no ice.
Because you get more if you go no ice and Haribo Starmix. If it's dark, you get a little bit of a, what's the sweet? Oh, you know what it is when you feel it.
Well, but, yeah, you
like,
know, you can feel out what it is. The gummy bears are the main kind of surprise, but it all tastes like sugar at the end of the day.
Yeah. I used to like them, but my teeth don't anymore.
You, man.
What movie are you looking forward to being released this year?
Oh, bruv, is there not... Oh, mate, Godzilla vs. King Kong 2. That's coming out. Dude, the boys? The boys are just linking up. Yo, I'm going to post a meme. No context. I'm just going to tag you on it. I'm going to post. I'm like, and that's it. That's my response to it. But yeah, Godzilla vs. Kong, New Empire? Yes.
I'm a Deadpool bitch. I'm there for Deadpool.
Oh, that'll be sick as well. But big monkey, big lizard. What is this, Monkey Monday?
I think the only Godzilla film I've ever seen is the one from with Matthew Broderick.
Dude, watch the 2014 one is all right, but watch King of Monsters, incredible, and then watch Godzilla vs. Kong. Godzilla vs. Kong is just a wrestling match.
I'll add that to my list with the Batman. Eventually, I'll get there. He's put in the last question that Broncello sent, Ace Guy Broncello, storyline SST character for Mania.
So I'm assuming Starship Troopers.
I'm assuming that as well.
Well, let's go. Well, obviously, it's Johnny Rico coming into NXT.
It's got to finish the story.
Yeah, Johnny Rico is finishing the story. So it's as the film goes. He's maybe part of a team. He gets one of the team like eliminated. And it's like, man, I can't keep going on like this. But then, oh my God, faction warfare. Johnny Rico has to lead the team. And he's like Survivor Series style. Everyone gets knocked off. And then he goes to WrestleMania and he has to beat his father figure, Radshack, in WrestleMania. And then finish the story.
So Johnny Rico is Sami Zayn.
Yeah. In all honesty, man, Johnny Rico is Sami Zayn. He's got the like NXT redemption.
We've got Ronan King just put Tren. And this is a question you asked him in last season as well.
Hey, Ronan, come in. Oh, no.
And Judas Gray's back with put me over, loser.
No, I put him over enough. Here's the thing. I've put him over enough.
And that last question we've got through here is Judas Gray, where's the penguin?
Well, I didn't think we'd lead this this podcast on such a sour note, but the Penguin is hurt.
Okay.
The Penguin is really hurt.
All right. Okay.
We don't know what happened. The Penguin's hurt. It's something to do with stairs, something to do with Catwoman. We're not sure, but I'm really concerned about the Penguin.
Okay. I'm just curious. We talked about, right, that's all the questions. Which hand did you break?
It's like,
was it your dominant hand?
So the Penguin, obviously, if he's falling down, sorry, on my hand, it's just hard to think right now, because the Penguin at, like, you know, we went to school together. And he's really hurt, like, you know, grew up together straight up. And it's just I don't know why you're laughing. I don't know why you're shaking your head like that. I really concerned about the Penguin right now. It was my dominant hand. It was my right hand. Yes, I broke my second metacarpal.
Oof.
But the, you know, we don't know what happened. Something to do with Catwoman, something to do with stairs. We put a card together for him. Gonna see him this week.
It's taking a bit 2 hours to for the awkward turn of the podcast. That's, I got so
good. I don't know what's awkward. I mean, the Penguin is her, you know, we grew up together, you know, like, I think we've, like, tried to organize, we're still trying to work out what's going on. No one saw it. Something to do with Catwoman. I think stairs were involved in a way. We'll be right back. We'll keep it right here. The Penguin is still hurt. Just trying to work out what happened.
Okay.
I don't know if you caught anything, but, like, something to do with,
Catwoman,
stairs. Yeah, something to do with stairs. We're just not sure what happened.
Okay, we'll try and take your mind off.
We'll be right back.
Oh, hell yeah.
A hot dog boss. I packed the house out with my homies so that you'd feel lost. So many friends to choose from, gosh. And you're nobody's favorite, like you're renamed Ross. Just mixed a monster with the Red Bull. Don't get bent out of shape, it's just a leg pull. It's so much fun when I go mental, that's fundamental. Got massive legend energy, you know that's central. Kicking ass and breaking teeth, now you need dentals. Where's your fans? I really wonder where they went, bro. You're making all this noise, I hear no words like instrumentals. Not like when they chant, Skinner, this fight's already over, I'm the winner. Got love for the beginners, but don't think just cause I'm signed I won't put you through the ringer. You're not ready for these raw power moves. Best believe I'm spitting truths. I'ma hit you with a complex flex, and if you look at me perplexed, that's disrespect. Don't need a third panel to know who's up next. I'ma leave you on the floor like bottom text. If you think you're hard, you're really not. Wanna disregard your boy, come take a shot.
Bruh.
If you think you're hard, you're really not. Wanna disregard your boy, come take a shot.
Bruh.
If you think you're hard, you're really not. Wanna disregard your boy, come take a shot.
Bro.
If you think you're hard, you're really not.
Wanna disregard your boy, come take a shot.
In my room, I've got a poster of a toaster. That's my idol, you know. I'll always catch you roaster slipping like a shovel in snow. Sitting smiling while they bite you's why we call you slow, bro. The people love it when I troll them, cause I put on a show. That's how it goes. You should start taking me seriously, though. I heard a few of you do anything for view.
But seriously, the Penguin is hurt. We're just trying to... No, something to do with Catwoman. Something to do with stairs.
We'll try and take your mind off it with my stellar notes here, which I didn't really write anymore. We didn't really put over Judas Gray. You got to the open mic final of Disco. That was cool. It was nice. It's the match of the month for February. Yeah. People voted for it.
At my expense, thank you.
I mean, it's still points on the board for the SWN 150. We might not hit the five match threshold.
Oh, we might get there, folks. We might actually make the list this time.
Might not, like you know, who really cares about this list? Honestly, some people do. That's the thing. Yeah. So I'm really just getting panicked. I want to get this to do over 2 hours. So anything else?
No, can we not? I've got food downstairs at this point.
Cool. Right. We'll patch it there then.
Literally, my girlfriend came in earlier. I said, yeah, okay. It's a shame the cats haven't come in. They usually like it when I make a bit of noise. I would have shown the cats, but I guess we'll see them another day.
So this has been an absolutely stellar first edition of season 7 of the SWN podcast with Ian Skinner. We have talked some wrestling at points, but mainly we talked about a film that is fascinating and you should all go watch it. If you want to plug your shit, where can people find Ian Skinner?
At Ian Skinner PW on all social medias, Instagram, TikTok, Threads, Twitter, X, whatever. I'm not going to make that joke because it's a redundant joke. Yeah, buy my merch if you want. Watch my matches. Tell me I'm good.
I think you're good.
Put me over, you know. You know, anyway. But yeah, I also, Billy, you better cut where I say we'll be right back, just like hard cut to an ad.
Find something. I will definitely do that. I will cut it out. Anyway, this has been the start of the season. I've got 4 more episodes already recorded and ready to go, so stay tuned. Manscaped, SWN20, 20% off. Shave your balls. Right.
We'll be right back. We'll be right back.